Dear friends, this is episode number 4040 of the Limitation Act. We have completed section 15. Now we go to section 16. 16 is applied generally, almost several cases, but it does not become so much of a matter of discussion. And decisions are also very rare. Let us see section 16. I will explain it in a simple, otherwise there is some difficulty. Effect of death on or before the accrual of the right to sue. So there is a right to sue. It accrues on a particular date. Death take place, death of the suitor, who would be the suitor, takes place before the accrual of the right to sue. What happens in such a situation? Subsection 1, where a person who would, if he were living, having a right to institute a suit or make an application, dies before the right accrues, or where a right to institute a suit or make an application accrues only on the death of the person, the period of limitation shall be computed from the time when there is a legal representative of the deceased capable of instituting such suit or making such application. See, A has a right to institute a suit. On a particular date, the cause of action arises. Would arise. He dies before that date. He has got children, but all are minors. No wife. So, all the legal representatives are minors. So, section 6 will apply. So, time begins to run from the date when there is a legal representative capable of instituting the suit. Two aspects are there in section 16.1. One, by a fiction, it is seen that if that person were living, he would have a right to institute a suit or make an application. But he dies before the right accrues. One. Second, the right to institute the suit or make the application accrues only on the death of that person. Two situations. One, if a particular date the cause of action arises, would arise, he dies before that date. Had he been living, he would have got a right to institute a suit or make an application. Then the first part applies. His legal representatives would be entitled to file the suit. But provided there is a legal representative capable of instituting the suit or making the application. The second one, the right to institute the suit arises only on the death of that person. Then, his same thing, his legal representatives would be entitled to institute a suit, but legal representatives must be capable of instituting the suit. There is no incapacity, disability or any other thing. Section 6 or any other provision may apply. That is subsection 1. Now let us see, that is the plaintiff. The person who dies is the plaintiff. A person who would have become a plaintiff had he lived after the date of cause of action, on the date of cause of action arises. Or death of a person takes place and that creates a right to sue. Both plaintiff. Now let us see subsection 2. Were a person against whom, if he were living, a right to institute the suit or make an application would have accrued, dies before the right accrues. In the earlier subsection also two parts, here also two parts. The only difference is that the first subsection is the would-be plaintiff or probable plaintiff, whereas this is, let us not say plaintiff, in whose favor the right would have accrued. In the second one, the person against whom the right would have accrued. Now, were a person against whom, if he were living, a right to institute a suit or make an application would have accrued, dies before that date, before the right accrues. Or when a right to institute a suit or make an application against a person accrues on the death of such person, the period of limitation shall be computed from the time when there is a legal representative of the deceased against whom the plaintiff may institute such suit or make such application. So these are subsections 1 and 2. Subsection 1 refers to a person who could have instituted a suit or would have been able to institute a suit had he been in existence, in life, had he been living, but he dies before the right accrues, or a right accrues only on the death of that person, then subsection 1 applies. Subsection 2 applies where against a person a right to sue accrues, would have accrued if he had been living, but he dies before that date, or a right to institute against that person would arise only on his death, then also subsection 2 applies. These are the two instances where. 3 says, nothing in subsection 1 or subsection 2 applies to suits to enforce rights of preemption. Preemption suit you are aware of. Or to suits for possession of immoral property. Or of a hereditary office. So for recovery of possession, declaration and other suits with respect to immoral property, this section has no application. That is why much of decisions are not available here. Particularly Supreme Court. I could not find any decision of the Supreme Court. You please also check up. But in other suits it applies. Other than preemption suits, suit for possession of immoral property or for say with respect to hereditary office. All other suits it applies. So how to explain it? I think I will read a passage from the commentaries. This is AER commentaries, easy to understand. I will read a few sentences so that it will be very clear. It is a general principle that unless there is a completed cause of action, limitation cannot run, and that unless inter alia there is a person who can sue and a person who can be sued, there cannot be a complete cause of action. Limitation cannot run unless there is a complete cause of action. And unless there is a person who can sue and a person who can be sued, then only the cause of action. Then there cannot be any complete cause of action unless this is satisfied. Now, I will read one paragraph for your consideration. One paragraph that will explain. the first part of subsection 1. I think, see, it can be best explained by reading it rather than my effort to read it. The first part of subsection 1 provides for cases where a person who would, if he were living, have a right to institute a suit dies before the right accrues, that we have seen. Similarly, the first part of subsection 2 refers to cases in which a person against whom, if he were living, a right to institute would have accrued, dies before the right accrues. Thus, both these provisions refer to cases in which a right to sue accrues after the death of a person, in circumstances in which such right would have accrued to or against such person if he were living. In other words, the provision referred to cases where a right to sue accrues in favor of or against the estate of a deceased person. So the right accrues not to the person because the person dies, to the estate of the deceased person. Now there is an illustration here. Thus, please make note of it. A contracts with B to pay B a certain sum of money on the 15th January 1930. Let us take it 15th January 2020. B dies on 10th January 2020. So, A contracts with B to pay B a certain sum of money before 15th January 2020. But B dies on 10th January. If B had been living on 15th January, a right to sue would have accrued in his favor on his failure to pay the money on that date. So, 15th January, if he were ever living and if he did not pay, B could have instituted a suit against A. B dies on 10th January. 15th January is the date. B dies on 10th January. If B had been living on 15th January, a right to sue would have accrued in his favor on A's failure to pay the money on that date. Suppose in the above illustration, A dies on 10th January. In such a case, if A had been living on 10th January, 15th January, a right to sue would have accrued against him on his failure to pay the money on that date. It is on A's failure to pay the money on 15th January, a cause of action accrues in favor of the estate of B in the first instance, and in the second instance, a cause of action accrues against the estate of A. A contracts to pay, so A is liable. So, in one case, it is against the estate of A, and in the other case, it is in favor of B. The right to sue would accrue. The first part of subsection 1 applies to the first case, and the first part of subsection 2 applies to the second case. Two cases, plaintiff, in favor of somebody and against somebody. If such cause of action accrues before the death of such person, the section does not apply. Section 16 does not apply. Although the right may be enforceable on behalf of or against him, against his estate of the deceased person. Right to sue accrues before the death of either A or B. Nothing stops. It accrues. Exclusion may be possible in some cases. But this is different. Now, the second part of subsection 1 and 2, only on the death of that person, accrues only on the death of that person. What does it mean? accrues only on the death of that person. Or where a right to institute a suit or make an application accrues only on the death of a person. Subsection 2. Or where the right to institute a suit or make an application against a person accrues only on the death of such person. So, in the first part of subsection 1 and the first part of subsection 2, it speaks of a case where the death takes place before the right to sue accrues. The second part of subsection 1 and the second part of subsection 2 applies where the right to sue accrues only on the death of the particular person. See the difference? The first part of it, I have given an example. The second part of it, I will give an example. Suppose there is a partnership. I am reading from the commentary. Suppose there is a partnership amongst A, B and C. A dies. A's death causes a dissolution of the partnership and gives rise to a cause of action in favor of his representatives to sue B and C for an account of the partnership business and for A's share of profit. A, B and C are partners. A dies. An automatic dissolution takes place. What is the right of A's legal representatives to sue B and C for rendition of accounts, for dissolution of partnership, gives rise to in favor of the for an account of the partnership business and for A's share of profits. In such a case, the cause of action owes its existence to the death of A. So the cause of action arises only on the death of A. That is a difference, where a cause of action would have arisen in favor of a person, but he dies before the cause of action arises. That is first part of 1 and 2. Second part is the person concerned dies only on the death of the person concerned a cause of action would arise. There, this partnership. One partner dies, dissolution takes place. Then for his legal representatives would be entitled to file a suit for rendition of accounts, for accounting and for share of profits. That accrues only on the death of that particular partner. So the cause of action arises on the death of a person. The other is cause of action arises before the death of a person. And then what will happen? This is a distinction. Such cases are very, very, very rare. But we apply it. We apply it every day. Say, you have to file a suit. You mean, say, your client has to file a suit against X. Your client approaches you. He says, sir, I got a right to realize certain sum of money against X. He died. So you will inquire who are all his legal representatives and take steps to institute the suit to against those legal representatives. Or it may also happen that after your client instituted the suit against X, he may die. Then the cause of action continues against his legal representatives, legal representatives of X. There the legal representatives are to be implicated. There Order 22 applies, of CPC applies. This is the... that therefore, we are seeing every day such cases. Without properly comprehending the scope of Section 16. 16 is there. Even though we do not analyze it in every case, the 16, the underlying principle, all of us know. And we apply also. But which is the provision of law? Section 16. That's all. Yes. Now we go to section 17. Section 17 is very, very important. To some extent difficult also. Difficult not on its theory, but on practical application. On practical application. Unless the facts are clear, nobody can assure a party that you will succeed on the basis of applying Section 16, except in exceptional cases. Borderline cases are there, sometimes it is difficult to prove. That is fraud. Effect of fraud or mistake, Section 17. Effect of fraud or mistake. Each word we will consider before reading Section 17. One thing must be clear. Fraud vitiates everything, even court proceedings, even any solemn act. Because there is deceit in the case of fraud, court will not promote fraud. And if a person has benefited by perpetrating fraud, the court will not allow that person to enjoy that benefit forever. The court will reverse it. Court will set aside, declare that it is void. The order which he has, or decree which he has obtained by exercising fraud, that will be set aside. It is void. Therefore, fraud is a very important thing. How to prove fraud? It's a question of fact. What is fraud within the meaning of Section 17? There also there is difficulty. Whether a person did not disclose everything in his plain or written statement, whether that amounts to fraud, or whether a deceitful act intended to mislead the court and intended to mislead the opposite party is put forward, whether it amounts to fraud. But for that, he would not have obtained a decree in his favor or an order in his favor, whether that would amount to fraud. How fraud is to be proved? Decisions say that fraud, like any other charge in a criminal offense, must be proved beyond reasonable doubt. One distinction is there between civil cases and criminal cases. In criminal cases, proof is proof beyond reasonable doubt. Of course, there are certain presumptions, may presume, shall presume, etc., conclusive proof, etc. Apart from that, and in every case, it is the duty of the prosecution to prove the guilt. Exceptions are there where there is some presumption under certain special statute like Narcotic Drugs and Psychotropic Substances Act. There are certain other new generation acts which provide for a burden of proof on the side of the accused if certain conditions are satisfied. But so far as civil cases are concerned, it is not proof beyond reasonable doubt. It is on the basis of preponderance of probabilities. That is a difference. And though both are aimed at arriving at the truth, the ways are different. And therefore, though it is in a civil case, the decisions are uniform to the effect that fraud, just like any other criminal charge, must be proved beyond reasonable doubt. However strange the coincidences may be, is the word used. However strange the coincidences may be, proof, it is not a substitute for proof. However strange the coincidences may be, it is not a substitute for proof. So, to prove fraud is very difficult. and there must be sufficient pleadings for founding the plea of fraud. These are all the aspects which we may consider. We will consider in the next episode. Thank you.